a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. Holy Spirit, may you reveal yourself. May you speak. And may you remove me from me too. Your son's name, amen.
Amen.
John 3:16. For many of us who grew up in the church, this is a verse that we can say without even flinching. Anybody with me? Verse for many Christians, a verse that many believe is at the heart of what it means to become a Christian. That if you really believe, you believe in Jesus, you will not perish, but you will have eternal life. And John 3:16 has had more of its fair share of fame in our world today. Maybe you've seen a John 3:16 sign as you drive down the 95. Or perhaps you've seen it while watching baseball, and it's at home plate on right on your screen. Or maybe you're a college football fan and seen it on some of those plates right under his eyes, those band-aid players. It's made its way into the public. In fact, I remember in middle school, a classmate of mine was in the bathroom with a Sharpie writing Austin 3:16. And I remember thinking, what is Austin 3:16? I know what John 3:16 is. And he goes, "Dude, it's wrestling." And I'm like, okay. So as I'm preparing for my sermon this week, I remember Austin 3:16. So I called my friend from college, who's a big wrestling fan, and I think he still pays for pay-per-views even at the age of 30. He's like, "Warner, Austin 3:16 is about this wrestler named Steve Austin. And in an off-the-cuff interview, he's mocking Jake the Snake," which is another wrestler, "who was a born-again Christian. And he says to him, 'You have John 3:16, but Austin 3:16 says, I just whooped your behind.' And Wes, in his infinite wrestling wisdom, told me that that line became his motto, and it lasted for over 10 years. And similar, John 3:16 has been this motto for many Christians. What's the story behind John 3:16? Many of us just know the verse, but we do not know the context of where it comes from. This comes in the middle of the story between Jesus and Nicodemus. Nicodemus, a Pharisee and a leader among the Jewish people. Nicodemus comes to him in the night. Why come at night, though? Most theological conversations happened in the day, so that people could see the discourse and hear what is happening. But Nicodemus comes to him in the night. Perhaps this was something that would be unpopular with his Pharisee friends. But he opens up by praising Jesus, saying, "Teacher, I know you come from God, because you cannot be doing the things you are doing without the presence of God." Nicodemus is curious about Jesus. He likes Jesus. But yet he comes at night. It's almost as he is a secret fan of Jesus. In sixth grade, I really liked a band named Hanson. And a song called Pumba, a bubblegum pop song that middle school girls were going crazy for. But as a sixth grade boy who was trying to be cool and trying to get girls to like me, there was no way I was going to admit that I liked Hanson. But if I wanted to listen to Hanson, which I did many, many times, I could be in secret about it. I could listen to it in the dark. So here we see Nicodemus as a secret fan of Jesus. And he tells Jesus that he's a fan. But Jesus responds in such an odd way. You would think Jesus would respond by saying, "Thank you for those kind words." But instead he says, "No one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above," or how others have translated, "without being born again." Now you can't fault Nicodemus for what he's about to say. He takes it literally. "What are you talking about? I'm literally getting older by the minute. How can I go back to the womb and be born again?" And I support Nicodemus' honesty. Sometimes in academic settings, a professor will say something profound, yet really confusing, that maybe one or two students know what the professor is talking about, yet the whole class goes, Nicodemus doesn't do that. He's a smart guy. He's a Pharisee. And he just says, "Jesus, what the heck are you talking about?" And perhaps this is the same feeling that one might feel if they're reading in the park and a well-intentioned Christian comes up to them and says, "Have you been born again? What the heck are you talking about?" So let's just name some things real quick. Things about the ways we view being born again and how it's been pronounced in the last 20 years or so. And I'll be honest with you, this term makes me feel uncomfortable. In high school, I ran with a crowd that was part of the born-again Christian community. I would go to festivals, I would go and sing songs. And when they would ask, "Are you born again?" what they really were asking us, "Are you saved like us? Do you interpret scripture like us? Do you vote like us?" And throughout time, I kind of left that movement a little bit, and I'm still uncomfortable with the word born again. I feel like it's been popularized to focus on an event simply about conversion, about a ticket into heaven. If you believe this thing, you will not perish, but have eternal life. But there's something true about being born again. And what we see in this passage goes beyond that. We see Jesus and Nicodemus speak. And Jesus gives them an invitation to come out of the dark, to not live in secret anymore. It's an invitation to not be a secret man, to be born into a new light, in spirit and in water. But here's the thing. Being born again is not simply an act that one does alone. I do not remember my own birth. But I know that I have a loving mother who bore much time, love, and nurtured me while I was in her womb. And I know that I didn't simply come out. My mother had to have me. What an incredible and loving gift she gave to give me life. And the invitation that Jesus is offering Nicodemus to be born again of the Spirit is an invitation to come out of the dark. And that doesn't come out of nowhere. It comes out of a loving God who has nurtured Nicodemus in her womb and is willing to give Nicodemus the beautiful gift of spiritual life. And like a mother, God is willing to walk and journey with her child as they learn, grow, and mess up. A life of being spiritually reborn is not done enough. Yet being born is scary. My roommate is preaching on this same passage this week at Highlands Park of Home Church. And we had our friend Elaine over for lunch. We were talking about this passage, talking about being born. And she brought such a beautiful insight to the conversation. She reminded us, what is the first thing that a child does when they're born? They cry. They're in a new and foreign situation, and it's scary. They long for the safety of their womb, and are now on the new challenge of a new life. She said that in a way, coming out of the womb is a form of death, but it's the beginning of a new life. And then she shared this quote from Toni Morrison with us. Our future is ripe. It's outrageously rich in its possibilities. Yet unleashing the glory of that future will require a difficult labor. And some may be so frightened by its birth that they will refuse to abandon their nostalgia for the womb. This invitation that Jesus gives Nicodemus to come out of the dark and be born into the light of spirit. It's filled with much possibility for Nicodemus. But what must he die to in order to have this new life? Perhaps it would require him to claim Christ in front of his Pharisee friends. That would be a scary death. Maybe he would lose his Pharisee card. But next time we see Nicodemus is in John 7. And here the Pharisees are trying to plan out a way to arrest Jesus. And Nicodemus stands up to Jesus. He says, you can't just arrest him. You have to have some kind of hearing to see if he actually did something. And the Pharisees accuse him of being a disciple. And then in John 19, after Jesus' death, he takes Jesus' body to make sure that he gets a proper burial. We are not completely sure where Nicodemus believed, but as we continue to see him twice more in the Gospel of John, it seems like he has taken steps. Perhaps he had to crawl first. Perhaps he had some hiccups. But he defends Jesus at that point, then makes sure he gets a proper burial. So friends, what must we die to in order to be born again? Perhaps being born again is not just a one-time event, but something that we do each and every single day. What must we die to in order to live? Perhaps we die to the things that hurt us so that we can truly live life. Perhaps we die to the things that keep us from loving God and our neighbor. Perhaps we die to grudges and indifferences. Perhaps we die to negative stereotypes of people, so that we can look them in the eye and see them as God sees them, as children of God. And when we die to this, we cry. It's scary. But there is an adventure of new life that is not that alone. It is then with a God who is like a loving mother who just bore us and then lives life with us. And it's also done with our sisters, brothers, and other siblings who are in this new life trying to figure it out along with you. So I invite you to die to the things that hurt.